I'm thrilled to have this opportunity to share a word of encouragement on the theme of caring for international students during the pandemic. As I prayed in preparation for this time, I believe the Lord led me to a story in the scripture that clearly speaks to our current situation, and it can easily be applied to your role as a volunteer serving international students. The story is found in 2 Kings 4, 1-7, and here's how it goes. The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that he revered the Lord, but now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves." Elisha replied to her, "How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your home?" "Your servant has nothing there at all," she said, "except a small jar of olive oil." Elisha said, "Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side." She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. And when all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another." But he replied, "There is not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. She went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go and sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left." There are three steps that God wants us to take in order to care for international students during the pandemic. The first is to acknowledge great loss. This story has a very sad component because it begins with a family that has lost a husband and a father, and as a result is in dire economic straits to the point where they have mortgaged everything, borrowed to the limit, and they're unable to pay. The result will be not just the loss of their house, but the loss of the sons of this widow woman. They are what the creditor is coming for. This is serious. This is what keeps this woman up at night. This is the great fear that she's facing, not only that she lost her husband, but now that she might lose her sons. This is a story of both emotional pain and economic pain. This is not the way she imagined her life would go. Trouble has come her way. She has lost everything except for her sons, and she's about to lose them too. Most of us are in a period of great loss. Some of us may have experienced the death of someone close to us, a family member, a friend of a friend, a person in our church, a coworker. It may not be the loss of a person, but the loss of a job, of a fellowship, of a ministry, of an opportunity, of the freedoms that you once enjoyed. To some degree, all of us have experienced loss during this season, during this pandemic. Painful losses that are not easily overcome, that grieve our souls and test our faith. We must and we should acknowledge these losses. We can lament like this woman does, like the psalmist does, like the Lord did over Jerusalem. But we must not stop here. The next step is to acknowledge what you still have left. Elisha asks this woman, "What do you have in your house?" This is important because God's supply in our lives begins with what he has already given to us. The focus is not on what she did not have, but on what she did have. She still had a small jar of olive oil. She started with the focus on nothing. She said, "Your servant has nothing at all." And then she adds, "except a small jar of olive oil." The amazing thing is God only needs a small thing to provide a miracle, to make supernatural provision, to show his power. We tend to get stuck on the loss part instead of seeing what's left. We tend to get stuck in our past losses so we don't recognize what God still has left to work with. God will always use what you have left. You know how God asked Moses, "What's in your hand?" All he had was a stick, a rod used by a shepherd. But God said it would become not the rod of Moses, but the rod of God. It seemed like a lifeless piece of wood, but it was all God needed to show his power to Pharaoh. You remember the feeding of the 5,000? It began with a boy with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. It wasn't enough to feed 5,000 people, but it was enough in the hands of Jesus. Jesus could have made bread out of stones, but instead he chose to use what the boy had, the little bit that the boy had. When God wanted to supply for the needs of the widow of Zarephath, he used the little bit of flour and the little bit of oil that she had. to supernaturally supply for her and her son over a long period of time. God begins with what we have. When we are in this period of the pandemic, God is asking you, what is in your house? What do you still have that you have not lost? Is it a hill with some snow on it? Then God can use it to show love to an international student as you sled down the hill. Is it a piano in your house? Then God can use it to sing songs, even if you do it over Zoom. Is it a stove? Then you can cook food and deliver it as an act of love to internationals. Is it a park near you? Then you can hike with your international friend. Is it cloth that can be made into a quilt? Then gathering students together to make quilts will be a great ministry. Is it a book that you could read together with an international friend? What is in your house? What do you have that you have not lost? This is what God wants you to use, even if it's just a jar of olive oil. Some of the hosts who have had great impact on international students were not those with large and gorgeous houses, but the single moms who had their kids sleep on the floor so the student could have a bed and feel welcomed. Or the couple who had one bedroom and gave it to their guest when they slept outside in a tent. Listen, the key to serving international students during the pandemic is not to focus on what we have lost, but to focus on what we have left. Most of the stories that have been shared by volunteers who have continued to care and serve internationals are not a bunch of amazing new things that have not been done before. They are the simple things that are still in their lives that they have decided to use at this time. Now, creativity is good, and it may be involved, but it's not so much about thinking up many new things, but utilizing what we already have. God's miracles begin when he takes what you think is small or overlooked or not that valuable and makes it a source of his provision. It becomes invaluable in the hands of God. Listen, I know you have something in your house, something in your life, something in your experience that is ready to be the means of God's miraculous power shown to you and to your international friends. What do you have in your house? The third step is to trust God for what is still needed and to do whatever he shows you to do. The little bit of oil is not enough to feed her family and to keep the creditors from taking her sons, but it will be the means of her supply. But first, she must go and borrow some empty jars. I mean, she's already borrowed all she could, and now she's supposed to borrow more in the form of empty jars? I mean, what is she doing? She's making room for God to work. There has to be a form to catch the blessing that God is about to pour out. This woman is told to get what is empty. This is unusual. Most people want to get what's usually in the jars, like the perfume, not just the jar. But God tells this woman to get empty vessels. They must be empty. And we must be empty in order to be filled. Every day we must realize that we are empty without God's Spirit. One of the realities of the pandemic is the prevalence of burnout. These empty jars can represent the way many people feel, empty, without energy, without passion, without motivation. Just like cars that are running on empty, there are many who are ready to stop doing what they're doing because there's nothing in their emotional or spiritual tanks. I wonder if you're feeling empty. This is different than just feeling tired. If you're tired, you can get some sleep and feel better. But when you're empty, the next day is just as difficult as the day before. People keep asking you, how are you? And you don't know how to answer because you're just feeling drained. This is what happens when donors experience something called compassion fatigue. Confronted with so much need over a sustained period of time, it results in a condition where you cannot respond anymore because you feel empty. You've run out of care. You say, I don't care because I already spent all my care, and now I'm empty. Empty is walking around and being sad even though no one died. Empty is not having the capacity to take care of your children anymore or intervene when they're having an argument with each other. Empty is running around without expression because you just don't have any more energy. But God, does great work in empty. When the world was void and empty, God spoke his creative word and brought order out of the chaos. When the disciples were in the upper room, they were empty. Otherwise, they could not have been filled with the Holy Spirit. But they were filled. Yes, God filled them with His Holy Spirit. The woman in this story discovered that God could fill the empty jars with the little bit that she had because He was able to multiply it. And the fact that it was oil is significant because oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. The only way to do ministry is by being filled with the Holy Spirit. And for those of us who are on the edge of burnout or who are headed toward burnout, hear these words from God. And God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will be able to abound in every good work. And another word from God. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. God is desiring to fill us up. He can take the little bit of grace that we are experiencing and multiply it so that the empty places in our lives, the void in your soul, can be filled. This woman only needs to borrow because eventually she's going to return the jars. The woman's distress situation is a temporary situation. This pandemic will pass. It is temporary. So we need the empty vessels now. One of the greatest gifts we can give to our international friends is to demonstrate what it looks like to be filled with joy and peace overflowing. One of the most powerful testimonies we can have right now is to overcome empty by being filled, to show that there is a supernatural supply that comes from God, to show the surpassing power of Jesus Christ. The woman saw the miracle when she shut her door. The jars were filled, not in public, but in private. So it is with us. Our private time with God is vital to being filled with the Holy Spirit. The oil flowed in proportion to the need. It stopped when the last jar was filled. You want to know how to serve, how to care for internationals during this pandemic? The most important way is for you to have a fresh experience with God and then to share how God has filled you with joy, to demonstrate the reality of God. Imagine, after the jars of this woman were filled and she went out and sold it and then returned the jars and tells the person, I don't need your jar anymore. And they ask, well, what did you need the jar for in the first place? And she shares the testimony of God's provision with them. You can have it back now. God gave it me so much. God supplied all of my needs. What step are you at? Maybe you're still at step one. Okay, don't pretend otherwise. You know, acknowledge, lament. But He wants you to get on to step two. And if you're at step two, good. You're making progress. You're seeing what God wants you to see, what He's given to you, what you have to offer to Him. But if you're at step two, God wants to get you to step three. And if you're at step three, you're a blessed person. You need to share what you received from the Lord, because when we are filled, we need to share so we can be refilled again. God wants to use you to care for international students, even during this pandemic. May God's grace and peace be multiplied to you.